This next panel, which will take us to lunchtime, is focused on the neighborhood environment and the built environment and grappling with how we understand its effects on health. And moderating that panel and introducing the speakers will be Dr. Monica Wang. Monica is an assistant professor in the Department of Community Health Sciences here at BU at the School of Public Health. She has a doctorate in social and behavioral sciences. Her research includes addressing racial, ethnic, and socioeconomic disparities in obesity and chronic diseases. She also recently published a paper on public policy priorities related to physical activity in the built environment, highly topical for what we're addressing here today. So she's really an ideal person to coordinate some of our discussion about how neighborhoods can influence health. Dr. Wang.
Thank you and good morning. At this time, I'd like to invite the panelists to come take a seat up front, and we'll invite you one by one to do your presentations. And first, I'd like to introduce Dr. Mariana Arcaya. She is an assistant professor of urban studies at MIT. Her training is in social epidemiology and urban planning, and her research focuses on the dynamic relationship between neighborhoods and health. Please come take a seat. Second on our panel is Dr. Yvette Cozier. She is the Assistant Dean for Diversity and Inclusion and Professor of Epidemiology here at the BU School of Public Health. Her research focuses on the social and genetic determinants of health, particularly among African American women. We also have Dr. Theresa, Osypuk, who is an Associate Professor in the Division of Epidemiology and Community Health at the University of Minnesota School of Public Health. As a social epidemiologist, she investigates how place and social policy influences health and health disparities. Lastly, we have Dr. Shakira, Suglia, who is an associate professor of epidemiology at the Rollins School of Public Health at Emory University. Her research takes on a multidisciplinary approach towards understanding health disparities, such as examining environmental stressors and social stressors on health outcomes, particularly among children and adolescents. Welcome.
Is it really time? Sorry about the false start before. Okay, I think I'm gonna navigate to my presentation here. So thanks for the kind introduction, Monica. My name is Mariana Arcaya, and as Monica mentioned, I'm an assistant professor of urban planning and public health at MIT in the Department of Urban Studies and Planning. And I'm so thrilled to be here, and so I appreciate the invitation, and I really appreciate the first few talks we've had this morning, and I think that what I'm going to try to do in my 15 minutes is sort of follow the arc of the day that is set up, starting with the science and kind of moving towards what we know. So what we know and what we can do about it. So I'm going to kind of use my charge to talk about kind of methodological approaches for isolating the contextual effects of neighborhoods on health as an excuse to talk a little bit about the science of how neighborhoods affect health, and then end with the mentions of a few intervention studies that I'm involved with that I think touch on some of the points we've heard today. So to talk about one example of how we can use exogenous variation in neighborhood level exposures and health, I'm going to give an example from a study that I'm involved with looking at survivors of Hurricane Katrina who were displaced after the disaster, and looking at how the neighborhoods that they moved to are associated with their health outcomes. And then I'm going to end with three examples of intervention studies. So Dr. Frumkin had gave us a really nice setup on some of the built environment factors that we in the public health and urban planning community are really concerned with. And one of these is urban sprawl. And so as Dr. Frumkin mentioned, we have really good evidence that sprawling neighborhoods, which we define as neighborhoods characterized by disconnected streets, segregated land uses, meaning where people live, really distant from where they shop and where they work, low density, and places with no discernible center. You're not sure when you've hit the middle of town, and often look like this picture here on my right of the screen. We have really good evidence that these types of places make it harder for people to walk. They're associated with increased motor vehicle traffic, and there's a lot of observational evidence that people who live in places like this tend to weigh more than people who live in more compact, walkable places. But we don't have really good sort of causal identification strategies for understanding if sprawl is a causal risk factor for weight gain. And so, we like to think about research as putting one brick in the wall of what we know. And so I'm going to talk about a study that I conducted with co-authors at Harvard to take a look at this by using data on Hurricane Katrina survivors. And so the idea here is that by looking at folks who survived Hurricane Katrina and were involuntarily displaced from their neighborhoods and ended up in places that I'm going to make the case were random with respect to their health, we can actually treat this as an exogenous source of variation, a random source of variation in their neighborhood outcomes, and see what happened in terms of their body mass index over time. And so this data comes from a study called the Resilience and Survivors of Katrina study, and it draws on data from a cohort of low-income, largely African-American mothers who were enrolled in a study prior to Hurricane Katrina, which struck in August 2005. And here are just some images. I'm sure everyone is familiar with the storm. It was one of the most costly and deadly natural disasters in our country's history. And huge portions of the city were flooded, as you can see from these images. So the design here is that we had a cohort of low-income women enrolled in a study. And in 2003, 2004, a couple years before the hurricane, they answered all sorts of questions about their health, their height, their weight, their social capital, their income, their employment, their education, their family structure. And Hurricane Katrina struck, and there was talk of canceling the study because how could we possibly find everyone after this disaster? But fortunately, the study was redesigned to become a study of disaster survivors and resilience in the wake of this storm. And so what we did here is we said, well, before Hurricane Katrina, these women were living in environments that had nice grid structures, were on average pretty compact, and looked a lot like the images that you see on the screen here. These are taken from New Orleans. Pretty dense, walkable streets. And after the storm, they were displaced to 31 different states. And this map is showing the paths of these women from New Orleans, 40% of whom had lived in the Ninth Ward prior to Hurricane Katrina, to their first post-disaster environments. And because New Orleans is a compact city, it's about two standard deviations more compact than the kind of average metropolitan area in the U.S. in terms of this, in terms of sprawl. A lot of these women ended up going to places that were much more sprawling than the places they had become. And so these are some images of areas that are near the actual addresses of centers where women ended up right after the storm. So we have, Dallas and Houston, Atlanta, for example. And these are just some images that are actually close to where some of these women ended up. And the street level view of what that means is we've all probably had to experience at some point in our lives or another. It's a total disaster in terms of the human scale. What is the experience of being in a sprawling environment? I'm sure everyone has personal experiences with this, that, darting across the street, risking your life, wandering through endless parking lots to try to get to a storefront, sidewalks that go absolutely nowhere, or no sidewalks at all, as the woman in the bottom left is sort of trying to walk in an unsafe environment. And so the real test as to whether we can use this data to understand whether displacement from relatively compact, walkable neighborhoods to more sprawling neighborhoods on average, whether we can use this data to understand if sprawl was a causal risk factor for weight gain really depends on our ability to say, was the displacement to these neighborhoods random with respect to women's health? And so fortunately for us, we had a mixed methods study. So we had in-depth qualitative data on a subset of our participants. And so the first obvious statistical test we can do is we can say, were any of the baseline characteristics of our sample predictive of the level of sprawl that our folks ended up in? And we could say, no, none of the baseline health factors predicted ending up in a more or less sprawling neighborhood. None of the baseline socioeconomic factors ended up predicting whether they lived in a more or less sprawling neighborhood. None of the family structure factors that we had measured ended up predicting whether people lived in a more or less sprawling neighborhood. And so the statistics said, you know, it looks as though the neighborhood characteristics after the storm were pretty random with respect to personal characteristics, but we also had our qualitative data to look at, and we looked back at that data and tried to understand why did you end up where you ended up. And we heard a lot of stories about, well, I ended up in Houston because my brother-in-law has a cousin, and you know, they thought they could help us find a job. So people were going where they might have known someone, often distant ties. This is somewhat random with respect to the built environment and people's health. We heard stories like this. Well, I ended up going to Atlanta because the eastbound traffic was lightest, and we ran out of gas and stopped there and kind of set down roots. Another story of a family that thought they were going to Dallas. They got on an evacuation bus. The shelter was full. They went to Houston. The shelter was full. And they ended up in Wiley, Texas, and that's where they were. So we have both the statistical evidence that where they ended up right after the storm seemed pretty random with respect to their health, and then also the qualitative data bear this out. Okay, so what did we find? What we found was that prior to Hurricane Katrina, the body mass mean body mass index in this sample was 28.8. People on average gained weight after Katrina. They also moved from more compact communities that 138.6 on the sprawl index, a higher level means a more compact walkable community, to communities on average that were about 108.6 on the sprawl index, so about a 1.5 standard deviation change going from more to less compact areas. And we just have a scatter plot of the change in the county sprawl index on the x-axis and the change in body mass index on the y-axis, which suggested that people who ended up in more sprawling communities gained more weight. And we run a bunch of statistical tests to see whether living in more compact communities were associated with lower weight gain. And that's sort of that's what the top coefficient in that top line of the table is showing. And if this treatment, the neighborhood exposure is random, as we add covariates about individuals, we shouldn't see that coefficient change, right? And that's exactly what we see. We see when we only look at pre-Katrina body mass index, pre-Katrina sprawl index, we get a coefficient that remains stable after we're adding age, after we're adding race ethnicity, after we're adding family structure factors, after we're adding socioeconomic factors. And only when we add what might be mechanisms, employment and income, do we see that coefficient change. And it looks as though moving to more compact communities might have actually masked some of the impacts of finding jobs and earning more money in some of the more sprawling areas. And so I just wanted to present this as, again, starting with the science, what are some of the tools that we have for trying to understand are neighborhoods actually causal in affecting health? This is one study on a non-generalizable population, massive changes in exposure to sprawl, right? Going from one of the more compact cities in our country to much less compact areas, but we do see meaningful weight gain among those, especially who are moving to the most sprawling areas. And so, again, one brick in the wall of you know, what we might be able to say about how sprawl affects health. And I just want to close with this and talk about the benefits of mixed method studies. So, in addition to the statistics, I think what really gives us confidence in this finding is that we can go back into our qualitative data where the participants were never asked about weight gain, they were not asked about sprawl, and we see stories like this all the time. I just picked one out. This is from one of our women. I think she ended up near Houston, and she was asked about her community, and she said, it's gated, so at night at 6 o'clock, the gates close. So it's pretty safe, but in New Orleans, I could put my baby in a stroller. We could take a walk down the street. But here you can't do that. I can't even put him in the stroller. And we heard stories like this over and over, and how much time people were spending in their cars after moving from a walkable community like the Ninth Ward in New Orleans to some of the more sprawling areas where folks had ended up on that map. And so just in the last 2 minutes, I just want to switch gears, and I promise to close with some thoughts on another approach I think we can use to understand whether and how neighborhoods affect our health, and that's by studying interventions to actually change neighborhood conditions. And I think this is where many of us are excited and want to be taking our research. I'm just going to quickly talk about three projects that I'm involved with. The first is a collaboration with Montefiore Medical Center in the Bronx and a community-based organizing group, the Northwest Bronx Collaborative, and a nonprofit called Block Power, where we are trying to see whether providing jobs and training to low-income men from the community on how to do green energy retrofits in low-income housing can provide jobs, reduce greenhouse gas emissions, reduce energy usage, improve indoor air quality, and also reduce exposure to pests. And so the intervention here is that a nonprofit, Block Power, is taking data from Montefiore Medical Center's asthma records. We've identified the buildings that have the highest concentration of repeat patients for asthma visits, and Block Power is targeting those buildings with a community organizing strategy, green energy retrofits, and also closer connections to clinicians here. We're talking about co-benefits, and I'm an urban planner, so this is what we like to think about, these sort of comprehensive solutions. The second I'll mention is a local intervention. It is in Chinatown here in Boston, where a community developer, the Asian Community Development Corporation, recently built 95 units of high-quality affordable housing in 66 Hudson Street, a development called One Greenway. 4,200 people applied for the lottery to get these 95 units. And so we've just started a study where we're surveying the lottery winners, and we are about to send the survey out to the waitlisted applicants to understand whether winning this lottery actually has causal effects on your health. And the great thing why I call this an intervention study and not a natural experiment is that the developer is completely on board with this and is ready and willing to use the data that we find out to adjust its programming to amplify any of the health benefits that the residents experience. And the final one I'll mention is a project that I'm involved with that is looking to evaluate the health effects of a private equity fund, a $30 million private equity fund called the Healthy Neighborhood Equity Fund, that provides gap financing for transit-oriented development projects that are explicitly designed to improve health by providing affordable housing, jobs, taking cars off the street, integrating green space into their designs, and placing these developments in on average, unhealthy communities around the Boston metro area. And we're going to be trying to understand whether this type of catalytic development improves health, but we also have a community-based participatory research component with residents to address this very issue of whether there's a concern with green gentrification. And so residents are involved in determining what is on our survey and in trying to understand, when you see these changes happening, how does it make you feel? Are you worried about being pushed out? What can we do about it? And so we're trying to move this from a community-based participatory research model to a participatory action research model based on this resident involvement. And so I just want to close with these thoughts. So, you know, I was asked to speak about what are some methods for understanding the contextual effects of neighborhoods on health, some reflections from my work. So I think we should be designing studies with causal inference in mind from the beginning, if that's what we're after, and trying to triangulate across multiple sources of evidence. I think we should be looking for opportunities to test interventions, and that requires partnering with multiple groups across multiple sectors that are actually embedded in communities. And I think that, you know, a lot of the evidence we have on neighborhoods and health comes from observational evidence that have relied on multi-level models. And I think that appropriate statistical models are necessary but insufficient for disentangling individual from neighborhood level risk factors. So with that, I will close.
So we have some time for one to two questions from the audience before we move on to the next presenter.
Yes. Jack?
So you showed the regression lines for urban density and weight gain, weight loss. Are there some outliers that surprise you? Have you gone back and said, gee, this defies convention? What is specific about those factors?
about in terms of specific places?
Yes, they might say something else is happening.
Yeah.
If it didn't follow the line.
So I was worried about that, particularly with Texas. We had a lot of we saw a lot of folks going to Texas, and I was concerned that there was something that we didn't quite understand because a lot of people mentioned that they had tried to follow their faith community, that pieces of churches had actually tried to relocate together. And so what we did was, and actually I see one of my co-authors in the audience, Peter James, but what we did was we actually reran the models of looking only within the Houston area, if we can, or only within, you know, this part of Texas, that part of Texas, only within, you know, this part of the country, that part of the country. And the results were pretty consistent. You know, obviously there are limitations to this study in terms of we were looking at folks pretty quickly after the storm. We don't know what the long-term wait trajectories look like. It's not a generalizable population, and I mean, but what is? And also, I think we just had such a massive change in the built environment that I'm not sure exactly how informative this is for making the case of, you know, if you add this one transit-oriented development project, you're not going to get a 1.5 standard deviation change in the sprawl index. And so is it a wholesale change in the environment? We don't understand the nonlinear effects there. And those are the things I was a little bit worried about. Yeah, answer the question.
So for your new study, are you able to not only track the stress effects of the people who won the lottery, but also for those who lost?
Yep. So the design there is that we have we've recruited and already surveyed those who won the lottery and who have moved into One Greenway. And we got about 65% of the families willing to participate in the study. And we are just about to send out a survey to the 4,100 people that remain on the wait list to see whether they've won any other lotteries to get into affordable housing and to understand their housing environment in terms of crowding, environmental exposures, thermal comfort, neighborhood environment, self-reported health status, financial stress, and that sort of thing. And so, you know, what we're looking to understand is not just what is the environmental effect of being in high-quality, affordable housing, but also is being able to be in affordable, stable housing, making it easier for people to eat healthy or, you know, remain on their medication adherence or reduce their levels of stress. So among the lottery winners who moved into the housing, I think about 10% had been formerly homeless or in shelters. And so this is a really big change for them. And so we're interested to see what the results show over time.
Great, thank you.
Where should I sit?
So I'd like to thank Dr. Mariana Arcaya for her presentation. From her research, we see that the need to develop and implement more neighborhood-level interventions is growing as we shift from understanding to intervening and ultimately improving population health. And thank you for providing some taste of the different types of interventions that may be implemented, such as engaging the housing sector and the economy. So next, I'd like to bring up Dr. Yvette Cozier, who will be presenting on her research from the Black Women's Health Study.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Jonathan Levy, for inviting me from not too far away, but to be here to present my some of the research. I'm going to be talking more about an observational experiment, a natural experiment, if you will, which would be the Black Women's Health Study, not an intervention study. But I began this type of work when I was a doctoral student, and it was always something that drew me to trying to understand the communities that I grew up in and observing Black women's health in the context of neighborhood. So one of the quotes that I saw early on in my research was that from Rossi, which really sums up what Dr. Frumkin has said and what Dean Galea said in his introduction, and what neighborhoods provide us. So they give us the medical facilities where we're born, the schools where we learn and get our job opportunities, where we live, how we meet people, where we work, and finally, where we die. And so neighborhoods are integral to our lives, as we've heard so far this morning. Put another way, the physical environment of a neighborhood, as we've just learned, can help with how we pursue physical activity, how we interact with other people, the resources that are available to us to enhance our health, whether it's diet or pharmacy, and certainly how we access healthcare. It's also very important to note that neighborhoods differ significantly by race in this country. And so it really brings up the question of whether it's context or composition. This always comes up within the context or whenever you're discussing neighborhood. And I'm going to talk about how we have approached this within the Black Women's Health Study. So as was also mentioned earlier, there are decades of research that show that there are significant disparities and certainly on the neighborhood level. Overall in health, African Americans or Blacks report far poorer health than their white counterparts, regardless of income and educational levels, and that those income and educational levels do not translate into, again, to better health and to better opportunity for housing. And in fact, a lot of middle class Blacks and very educated Blacks are really more likely to live in poorly designed or poorly resourced neighborhoods compared to their white counterparts. So this is really the context in which helped drive my research hypotheses. Here's another quote from Sampson and Wilson, looking at over 100, almost 200 cities in the United States in which there was not even one city where Blacks and whites lived in ecological equality in terms of poverty rates. And the worst urban context in which whites reside is considerably better than that of the average context of Black communities. So this is something that we must keep in mind. So our goal within the Black Women's Health Study was primarily to study the cancer and other outcomes in African-American women. And as a doctoral student, I was given some leeway to really look into the other things that might be contributing to health disparities. So we really want to look at the effects of neighborhood characteristics within the communities in which Black women lived. And our main working hypothesis was that low neighborhood SES was associated with poorer health outcomes, independent of individual level risk factors. So for those who are not familiar with the study, the Black Women's Health Study began in 1995 when over 59,000 African-American women responded to an unsolicited mailing of a 16-page questionnaire. Most of the participants were subscribers from Essence magazine, but we also enrolled women who were members of professional organizations, churches, who were related to early responders, and so on. The questionnaire gathered lots of demographic and lifestyle factors, medical history, and we've been mailing questionnaires every 2 years since. So we're now about to go into our 2017 cycle or into our 22nd year of follow-up. A little bit on the characteristics of the participants at baseline. And the median age was about 38, so it was a young cohort. Over about 80% had beyond high school, and the women came from all regions of the United States. So on the educational front, that 80% of our participants had beyond high school was often a bone of contention with NIH reviewers and journal reviewers. They felt, well, these are educated women, Black women. Why are we studying health in them? There's nothing wrong. And we actually believe that this is the perfect population to study. And because of the quotes that I gave you earlier, what we know about the ecological context in which Blacks and whites live, will we see reduced health outcomes with women who are educated, or will we see better health outcomes? So this is, again, another driver of the research. For each of the women, we linked their neighborhood, their address, their residential address, to census data. And if you're not familiar with the census, it collects data every decade, traditionally, and The data follow a hierarchy from state level, and counties are nested within the states, and census tracts that have about 5,000 to 8,000 people are then nested within that. And a lower measure is the block group, which averages about 1,500 to 3,000 women. We selected to look at the block group level. That was the lowest level or the most granular level that we could look at that would give us a way of judging what was outside of the door of the participant, where they lived, rather than asking for a description of what their neighborhood consisted of. There are many hundreds of census variables that are available. These are a list that we selected based on previous research by others in this area, as well as a few that we were very interested in, particularly the percent African Americans, which we use as a proxy measure for segregation. We analyzed the variables in a couple of ways, one in which we combined them into an index, but also we looked at individual variables in relation to health outcomes. We have several covariates that we were able to include in the analyses that were risk factors for hypertension or other health outcomes. And which I don't have on here, use Cox proportional hazards models to generate incident rate ratios. So first, our basic table one, just to look a little bit at the distribution of the variables here. These are the median housing rate. So here we're using a single variable, median housing, rather than an index. But what's important, why I put this slide up, was if we look at the number of women who have higher education, 16 or more years of education, among those in the lowest housing value neighborhoods, you still have almost 40% of the women there had had college or higher living in these communities. And if you look at family income, still about 31% were in the highest category of family income, living in these lower SES neighborhoods as described by the census variables. So there's quite a bit of incongruity, if you will. Again, getting back to that issue of between, is it the neighborhood or is it just the people? Okay, the context versus the composition. Our overall data, we see here that there is an effect according to neighborhood SES using the high neighborhood or median housing value category as the reference, as the level of the housing value decreases, we can see that the risk of developing hypertension over the 6-year period increased. We then looked within categories of some of the risk factors. So BMI is a major confounder in the relationship of hypertension. So we looked among those women who were in the lowest category of BMI. So they would be technically at low risk of developing hypertension through that pathway. And what we saw was the same association, but a little bit stronger. So compared to those women who lived in high SES neighborhoods, as defined by housing value, women who lived in the lowest had a higher risk of developing hypertension over this time period. And also we did the same with education, looking at the women who were the most educated in our cohort compared to where they lived, we could see that there was a bit of a dose response there. To wrap up quickly, we have gone on to do many other analyses regarding neighborhood with other outcomes. We've looked at incident diabetes, in which we've seen a similar association. We've seen positive associations inverse associations with 10-year weight gain, incident obesity, and we've also been able to look at segregation. So the percent African American and being able to look at it over many years. So women who stayed in the most segregated neighborhoods over time also gained the most weight over time. We've looked at serum biomarkers of inflammatory biomarkers, cardiovascular and metabolic biomarkers, and these are all influenced by neighborhood socioeconomic status. mortality, all cause, as well as cancer mortality, and most recently we've looked at the association with asthma in neighborhood SES. So just to conclude, you know, neighborhood of residence, as we've heard today, is a very important determinant for health. And it is an important determinant even after controlling for individual risk factors. So women who are in those low-risk categories still have that effect of neighborhood, even if they are highly educated. If they're living in a poorly resourced neighborhood, it gets under their skin in very important ways. I know that we're going to have further discussion about this and that there are speakers lined up for later in the afternoon, but in terms of my thoughts on public policy, you know, residential environment is very important. I was very happy to see that someone was here from Boston City Council. That's great, and I'm glad you're a graduate of our program. But I totally agree with trying to echoing what you're saying, trying to involve public health as well as planning. And usually public health comes long after planning has been completed, a building is done. If we can try to maybe change that timeline and so that we can work together, these are things that hopefully we can provide good neighborhoods, neighborhoods that provide their residents with the things they need across the life course more consistently. So with that, thank you. And if you'd like to learn more about the Black Women's Health Study, it can be found on the website.
Great, we have time for one question.
Solved all the problems. Right? That's right. Okay. That's,
okay. Next, I'd like to welcome Dr. Theresa Osypuk, who will be discussing her research around another intervention around neighborhood level studies.
And there's a pointer here. Yeah. Okay.
So, how does where you live affect your health and disentangling some of the mechanisms? I'm going to talk about conclusions from some of my work from a housing experiment. So, if you look across the US, there's remarkable variation in life expectancy and other various health measures across place. And this geographic variation has been a primary motivating factor of my work. So a baby girl born in 2013 has a life expectancy of 81 years, but this varies substantially depending on the county where she's born. There's a 14-year difference in life expectancy between the highest and lowest counties. So a 14-year difference, how big is this? This is a big change. And just to show you how large, this shows life expectancy across time from 1880 through 2011. And it's taken the U.S. 65 years to gain 14 years of life expectancy. So currently we have that gap between the highest and lowest counties in the U.S. My work uses a geography of opportunity framework. And opportunity is defined very simply as a situation placing an individual in a position to be more likely to succeed. Opportunity varies vastly geographically within the context of neighborhood-based opportunities and opportunities at every level geographically. And these opportunities shape people's lives. So here is a graphic of how opportunity is operationalized. This is an opportunity map derived from 19 indicators that the Kerwin Institute developed for the Boston metro area for the Massachusetts legislature. Low opportunity neighborhoods are in light yellow here at the center of the map, concentrated in Boston City, whereas the suburban areas around here are disproportionately maroon, which is the highest opportunity quintile of this index. And this is a well-established pattern that central city areas have lower opportunity than suburban patterns, replicated in most of the metropolitan areas in the country. And although race is not incorporated explicitly in this index of opportunity, there are stark racial patterns of the distribution of racial populations across opportunity neighborhoods, just as Yvette discussed in her opening remarks. So you can see here that over 90% of Latinos and African Americans in the Boston metro area live in the lowest two quintiles of neighborhood opportunity, compared to only about a third of whites, and whites are disproportionately in the highest quintiles of neighborhood opportunity. These opportunity patterns are one outcome of the strikingly large racial residential segregation in the U.S., which persists even today. So this depicts the 2010 census data, racial segregation starkly in the New York metropolitan area, where each dot represents 25 people by race ethnicity. So this is one of the most segregated areas of New York, and these pictures, this picture specifically for New York, comes out really stark because of the dense population in New York. But we see other patterns for Boston, which is also highly segregated, and other metropolitan areas, much higher than the mean, and that's very high, even in 2010. It's not living with racial ethnic minority neighbors per se that is detrimental for minority health. It's the resources, opportunities, risks, and stressors that are associated with neighborhood environment and the regional environment. And one main pathway here is the quality of neighborhoods living in higher poverty neighborhoods with higher rates of crime. Another pathway is socioeconomic advancement, social determinants of health, and healthcare are all pathways by which racial residential segregation influences health. So racial residential has therefore been deemed a fundamental cause of health disparities and has been linked with worse health among minorities for a variety of health outcomes empirically. So addressing racial residential segregation may be necessary to meaningfully improve health inequities. I'm going to focus on one housing policy today and to try to discuss how social and economic policies may influence these factors to influence health. So this housing policy has the potential to promote to reverse segregation on a small scale, to improve opportunity and promote health equity for some populations. This is the Moving to Opportunity for Fair Housing experiment. This experiment uses the Housing Choice Voucher Program, which has been known historically as the Section 8 program. This is the largest investment in federal affordable housing. This is a social experiment of voluntary neighborhood relocation conducted by the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, begun in the 90s, among low-income families living in highly distressed public housing developments at baseline in five cities: Baltimore, Boston, Chicago, New York, and L.A. The families were very disadvantaged at baseline. They had at least one kid under the age of 18, and the goal was to disrupt the toxic effects of high neighborhood poverty on economic outcomes like welfare reliance. When it was launched, it was touted as one of the most promising policies to disrupt these toxic effects of neighborhood poverty for minority families. So families were randomized to receive a Section 8 rental voucher, which is a governmental subsidy of rent in the private rental market, where participants pay about 30% of their household income towards the rent, and the subsidy makes up the difference up to a ceiling that is set for the area. So it was a randomized trial where families were randomized to one of three treatment groups at baseline. One group was the Section 8 voucher group, and this group received the housing vouchers to subsidize rent, so they moved out of public housing into a private rental unit that qualified for use of the voucher under the rules. There was no locational requirement, though. They could move anywhere where the subsidy would be accepted in the private rental market. So this is an unrestricted voucher group or the traditional voucher group. The second group, the MTO, Low Poverty Neighborhood Voucher Group, sometimes I'll call it the experimental group, was the housing mobility group. This is the group that received a housing voucher as well, but they had a locational requirement. They couldn't use their voucher anywhere. They had to use their voucher only in a neighborhood where less than 10% of residents lived in poverty. So these were low poverty neighborhoods that they were that the rules guided them to live in. In order to counteract this locational constraint, they also received housing counseling from local nonprofits to locate suitable units. The third group was a public housing control group. They remained in the public housing and had no constraints, but they also received no vouchers. So this is a simple causal diagram of the timeline of the assessments. Random assignment was in 1994 to 98. Two program evaluations were conducted in 2002, 4 to 7 years after random assignment, and then in 2008 to 2010, about 10 to 15 years after random assignment. Health was not originally included in the design or the logic model of this study. It was primarily focused on economic outcomes. And as a result, as a result of preliminary research, the investigators did include health because they found that that was emerging as some of the primary effects of the policy. So they included a range of physical and mental health measures, which were evaluated primarily by survey. So the first question, is the MTO housing voucher treatment a cause of mental and physical health? The short answer is yes. So here I'm showing you the original investigator results, that mental health was better at the final evaluation, 10 to 15 years after the family received the voucher, among adult women and girls in the housing mobility or experimental treatment group that moved to low poverty areas compared to public housing controls. On measures like psychological distress. And this finding was similar in the short and the long-term evaluations. MTO also affected physical health, but the findings are predominantly present for adults, not kids, and only for some of the physical health measures. So here we see that obesity and diabetes were lower among the adults in the low poverty group here. And the Section 8 group had about comparable effects. And then diabetes here, where the effects were primarily in the low poverty group compared to the control group. But there were few effects of MTO on the physical health of children or adolescents. So among whom did these effects emerge? I'm going to focus here on the adolescents and get into my own team's research. So for these graphs, we combined the two voucher groups together in most of our analyses here because their effects were the same for adolescent health, which is an interesting question. If anybody has questions about them, I'm happy to talk about it. We and others found that there was no main effect of MTO on adolescent mental health when both genders were analyzed together, and this is because they had completely opposite effects that were canceling each other out in about a 50-50 distribution in the sample. So there were striking effect modification by gender. Girls benefited from being in the MTO voucher groups. The bars below the x-axis in terms of better mental health compared to controls for three different mental health outcomes. And the boys were harmed by the policy. Higher risk of mental health problems if they were in one of the housing voucher groups. To help understand these gender patterns, which are very difficult for the housing advocates and housing policymakers to understand, especially these adverse effects, we sought to explore whether all boys were experiencing the harms or whether it was concentrated among some subgroups. So we tested whether a family's baseline health-related vulnerability adversely modified the MTO treatment effect based on prior evidence that frailer subgroups may not benefit from an intervention to the same extent as more robust or healthier families and individuals. And these findings among subgroups have policy implications for enhancing and improving the program. And that's what we found, that health-related vulnerability of a family adversely modified treatment effects. So here we have two different modifiers that we examined, looking at psychological distress as the outcome. The effects for boys were not spread equally across these groups. They were the adverse effect for boys was concentrated among this group whose families had health vulnerabilities at baseline or whose families had been victimized by crime in the prior 6 months before baseline. And then the effects for girls were concentrated in, the beneficial effects were concentrated in families that did not have these vulnerabilities. So why these opposite effects by gender? So this is the objective of our research grants, to probe this striking gender difference. Some qualitative work suggests that the environment related to sexual harassment and sexual violence improves substantially with moves to lower poverty areas. And then this dimension is particularly relevant for girls, but less relevant for boys. The boys' social networks may have been disrupted, and some evidence suggests that boys are less adaptable to such change. The socialization that boys learn in order to survive and adapt within high poverty areas that is socialized very early, because the mean age of this sample here that I'm showing you was age 10 at baseline. So relatively young socialization, but that this socialization may have been maladaptive when moving to lower poverty areas. But we're currently continuing to test some of these hypotheses. Another hypothesis that I'm going to show you are there sensitive periods when MTO effects were more influential for health? So probing whether certain times of the life course are more sensitive. We know that adolescence is a period of dramatic biological, psychological, social changes that shape health. And our research led by colleague Nicole Schmidt is finding that when kids were older at baseline, particularly over the age of 9, the effects of the MTO program are more magnified. So the magnification of the effects by age is building on these opposite gender findings where MTO is harmful for boys and beneficial for girls. So boys who are 9 or older at baseline had larger adverse treatment effects for each additional year of age. And this is risky behavior, I believe. And for girls, the overall effect of MTO was beneficial. No, it's risky substance use. But each additional year of age conferred a more beneficial effect. Okay, so we have this age effect on top of the gender effects. Did MTO change families' exposure to neighborhood quality? So here we're getting into some of the proposed mechanisms of the MTO Health Association and the charge of this panel to try to separate the individual and neighborhood level factors. So by design, the participants in the low poverty treatment arm of MTO were expected to move to substantially lower poverty neighborhoods compared to the other treatment arms. And keep in mind, there was only about a 50% compliance. So we have a lot of non-compliers that are watering down the effect. But the short answer is here, yes, MTO did change the neighborhoods that experimental families lived in. And here's a graph of the poverty rate of the neighborhoods 1 year after random assignment. And this is the low poverty arm, which is shifted much lower than the Section 8 arm and the controls. So you'll see that, you know, some of the controls did end up moving. They just didn't move with the voucher. And what we see and what is most striking to me is that even 5 years and 10 years on, we still see this difference. The two voucher groups are converging on each other, but they still have a statistically improved neighborhood poverty environment compared to controls 10 to 15 years after random assignment. So here's the first how of how neighborhoods are affecting health through neighborhood concentration of poverty. In research led by Quinn Nguyen, our team probed the patterns of neighborhood quality that were achieved by neighborhood families beyond poverty. So from a quilt of data we compiled of various subjective and objective sources, we found that families in the voucher group experienced substantial improvements in neighborhood conditions across the board, across most of the measures that we examined compared to the public housing control group. And that included economic conditions, so the so-called compositional effects, as well as things like collective efficacy, violent crime rates, and neighborhood disorder. And we have a paper in Press at Housing Policy Debate presenting all these indicators. And there's a lot of variation in the types of indicators we could get for each city. So you see there are things like green space and parks and things that vastly improved. Second, was there site variation in improvements in neighborhood conditions across the five MTO cities? Sites have not been examined much in this study, but site effects are very common. They're common in social experiments. They're common in multi-site trials. People often don't know what to do with site effects, but it's important to understand, they're important inferences for how place affects health here. Yes, we saw site effects, and the site effects were largest for New York and Los Angeles in terms of the neighborhood quality improvements that the voucher group achieved compared to controls. And the difference was particularly large when we used administrative or objective measures compared to subjective measures. So these site effects suggest that neighborhood inequality is context specific. Different cities generate different effects, and there are very different distributions of neighborhoods in different metropolitan areas. So here are the treatment effects of MTO on collective efficacy in three of the cities where we had population-based collective efficacy measures that were derived at the neighborhood level, and then we link these to where the MTO participants moved. You can see the largest effects were for the New York experimental low poverty group compared to the control group. And here we have collective efficacy as well as three of its component scales. And somewhat smaller effects for Chicago, but again, the experimental group achieved much better outcomes than the Section 8 group compared to controls. There was also some qualitative effect modification by site for behavioral problems among boys, and this is fascinating. In three of the MTO sites, New York, Boston, and Chicago, we see the adverse effects that, when we average across the sites, emerged in the graphs I showed you before. But in LA, the treatment effect was beneficial, marginally significant, but still beneficial. And so this suggests that different health effects may emerge from the different contexts of the cities. So we're probing these site effects as well, and some of our colleagues are using some newly developed causal methods to try to understand whether this might be due to transportability of the different compositions of the different types of people who live in different places. Why did MTO influence health? So I showed you some of the suggested mechanisms that we examined with intent-to-treat models, but here, we're examining different health outcomes in the MTO study using newly developed weight-based causal mediation models, the inverse odds ratio weighting method, to try to understand some of these. So in a game-changing paper published in SSM a couple years ago, we found that none of our potential mediators actually mediated the adverse effect of MTO on adolescent asthma among the treatment group versus controls. Very frustrating. We found some mediation that was countervailing, but that in and of itself was interesting, that none of the factors that we measured is accounting for the treatment effect. In a paper last year in American Journal of Epidemiology, we documented that the economic dimensions of the neighborhood partially mediated the effects of MTO on the adult beneficial outcomes on BMI and obesity, where a neighborhood's economic status was operationalized through factor analysis of different census measures. And then in two papers in process currently, we're finding different mediators for adolescent mental health, including substance use at the individual level and neighborhood social and physical disorder at the neighborhood level. So we're trying to separate these individual and the neighborhood factors, but neighborhood factors are emerging as more important, and we think this is because they're further upstream and closer, with a closer link to the treatment. And the effects there are more compact, and the more downstream you get over time, the more pathways that emerge, including the individual level effects, which are more diffuse and harder to capture collectively. So here, one of the take-home measures is place affects the health of people differently. We found considerable heterogeneous treatment effects on improving neighborhood environment, via housing voucher policy, which is an indirect way of inferring how neighborhoods affect health. We found differences by adolescent gender, age, city, and baseline health vulnerability. And these results are reinforced not only by our intent to treat models, which I've focused on here, given my short time, but also instrumental variable models, where we rule out selective compliance as an explanation, as well as machine learning models, where we just published this here in American Journal of Public Health that allows us to model subgroups defined by several modifiers simultaneously, not just testing a baseline variable with treatment, which is traditionally how effect modification in a trial is tested, developmental scientists would say, this is not surprising, variability is expected, and kids take all different paths to healthy development. But heterogeneous treatment effects are also important from a translation perspective, so we can better target or tailor the policy to different groups. High racial segregation is a central feature of urban inequality in America and strongly patterns neighborhood context as well as social determinants of health and health. To change health outcomes, it may be necessary to change these fundamental causes like segregation in neighborhood context, which seems like a monumental task. But as Len Syme has written, it doesn't take a revolution. Policy is changing every day, and we invest in continuing certain policies all the time. Jim House's recent book, Beyond Obamacare, argues that policies outside the health care sector are important as levers for changing the social determinants of health and improving health, even if they're not intended to do this. And my work with this MTO study is one example of a consequential epidemiology, as Dean Galea has remarked. The translational social epidemiology research, there are certainly limitations to this study, which I'm happy to talk about, but the strengths, I believe, are unmatched in terms of causal inference, which is allowed by this experimental design, and we're pairing this design with causal mediation methods and machine learning to try to unpack these effects. It's important to remember that this housing choice voucher program remains underfunded, severely underfunded compared to demand for housing among low-income populations. This project was, $70 million governmental investment. And health researchers have had a limited access to the data from this experiment, but I think we need to learn all we can from this major existing affordable housing policy, since it has the potential to influence population health and promote health equity. Okay, thank you.
So we have time for one quick question.
So in previous discussions on the MTO study that I've heard, one theory that's been advanced for this gender difference has to do with the idea that while the girls integrated into their new neighborhoods better, the boys stayed in their gangs from their old neighborhood. Would you comment on that?
Yeah, so we didn't see that the boys were, empirically with the limited measures that we had, that the boys were staying behind in the neighborhoods more frequently. We didn't disaggregate that by age because, the kids were, of age in this cohort, age 5 to 15 at baseline. And then after 4 to 7 years, we examined the 12 to 19-year-olds. So there's a small group of the kids that were of the age where they could travel back and forth and had more autonomy. But there were a lot of young kids that weren't involved in the traveling back and forth. But we haven't been able to find much about the social connectedness, despite this qualitative work that suggested that. We haven't found those to be important mediators, at least for the health outcomes that we've examined to date.
Is there any connection with studies elsewhere? There's a cohort being started in Brazil with 100 million people, where there's a very big social housing program has been implemented by the Lula government over 10 years. And there's ways of making a connection between the databases. So these people are starting a big program of research to look into that. Have you looked elsewhere to people doing or having the possibility of analyzing those kinds of things?
There are other programs that... Oh, repeating the question, have we looked elsewhere? There's a program in Brazil that is linking data sets to examine the effects of social housing on health. There are other studies that use different natural experiments to leverage the causal inference for understanding effects of social housing. There's also a lot of observational evidence. The data linking, I think, is really key. Hooking into administrative databases, which are comprehensive and universal, if they are universal. So you can understand some of the beyond some of the self-report measures that we have. especially over time. So I'd be curious to see more about that study. I'm not familiar with it.
Oh,
you have to move on. Okay. Well, thank you.
We have time for a general discussion at the very end, and in the interest of time, I'd like to welcome our final speaker, Dr. Shakira Suglia, who will be continuing on the theme of using multi-level methods to improve and advance the built environment and health.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation to be here today. It's really a pleasure. So I'm going to speak about the neighborhood social environment and its role in obesity prevention. And I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues at Columbia University who've helped me sort of formulate this work, as well as my colleagues, Christiane Duarte and Glorisa Canino, with whom I'm collaborating in my current data collection project. So when we think about the neighborhood environment, we tend to think of sort of these two factors, the neighborhood social environment and the neighborhood physical or built environment. And in terms of the neighborhood built environment and its relation to obesity, we've had a lot of data. There's been a lot of work noting relationship between built environment, and this is in the x-axis you have here. This is state level data showing an index of the quality of the built environment, so access to recreational facilities, access to healthy food establishments, walkability. So the lower the built environment index, the poorer the quality of that built environment and its relation to obesity. And what we see is what we know, that built environment, lower quality built environment, there's a higher prevalence of obesity, and this is at the state level. And this relationship is sort of somewhat accepted to the point that Healthy People 2020 actually has goals of building the built environment for the promotion of physical activity. Now, a more sort of neglected, at least in the research literature, factor of a neighborhood environment is a neighborhood social environment. And the neighborhood social environment, which you know you've heard from the previous speakers, it's really the social demographic composition, or it's defined as a social demographic composition of the neighborhood residents, as well as the relationship between those residents, the social processes that exist between individuals in a given neighborhood. In relation to obesity prevention and obesogenic behaviors, it unfortunately hasn't been as big of a focus in the literature. Now, conceptually, the importance of looking at the neighborhood social environment is that it is affecting the built environment, and the built environment is also affecting the social environment, and they both actually have pathways through obesity. We know that neighborhood socioeconomics, of course, is going to affect the built environment, so the parks, the food establishments that are in a neighborhood, but will also impact the levels of crime, the perception of safety of the residents, as well as other social factors such as social capital, cohesion, efficacy, networks, and of course residential segregation or racial segregation. These relationship is bidirectional, so a neighborhood where there is high social capital or where there are high levels of connectedness among individuals that are able to galvanize and say, for example, convert an empty lot into a playground, that is an example of a neighborhood social factor influencing the built environment. At the same time, that playground presents a physical space, an opportunity for people to actually connect and then further develop that social capital. So this relationship is bidirectional. It also modifies, built environment modifies the relationship with the social environment and obesogenic behaviors as well as obesity. So we can think of recreational facilities or parks, but if there's a high level of crime, they're not going to be used as often, and so the levels of physical activity will decline, moderated by the levels of crime in a particular neighborhood. And as we saw, or we heard, neighborhood social environment is associated to mental health, and mental health can impact obesogenic behaviors as well as physiologically promote obesity. So in general, this is how we think the neighborhood social environment, or we conceptualize the neighborhood social environment, is embedded within the larger picture of neighborhood, and it impacts these pathways leading to obesity. In the literature, the social environment of neighborhood has been characterized as, you know, these factors, neighborhood SES, collective ecstasy, social norms and networks, which are not restricted to neighborhood environments but are important in neighborhoods, as well as crime, safety, and segregation. And I won't be able to show you the evidence for all these factors, but I'll touch a little bit on what we know for crime and safety and segregation in relation to obesity. So this data comes from the Fragile Families and Child Wellbeing Study, where perceptions of neighborhood safety were associated with obesity among women, and these are women of childbearing age. Fragile Families is a birth cohort that's followed children from birth now to actually age 15. And what we see is that with low levels of perception of safety, the prevalence of obesity is highest, and this isn't a dose, you know, shows a dose response relationship. Among adolescents, neighborhood safety has also been associated with obesity. Here we're looking at, this is a cohort of adolescents in Minnesota, and this is a particular data for girls, where we're looking at both built environment factors, but also some of these social factors, particularly neighborhood safety, perception of safety during the night, and perception of safety during the night and day is associated with a higher BMI and Z score among girls. And I should note that, as it was alluded to before in terms of gender differences, these associations were not found in adolescent boys. And the pathway, or the most sort of studied pathway by which we think neighborhood safety is affecting obesity, has been physical activity. This is a study by Gary Bennett, actually here in Boston, looking at housing, public housing residents, where they measured actually steps taken, you know, via pedometer, daily steps taken. And there is a dose response relationship between levels of safety in a neighborhood and the steps taken, that it's not evident among the men, but it is evident among the women, with the most unsafe neighborhood, the lower levels of actually steps taken within a neighborhood. These gender differences are alluded to in terms of, or they're sort of justified as, well, women are actually more vulnerable to the effects of violence. They may be more fearful. They're actually may be more often the victims of violence, and hence we see a greater effect in terms of neighborhood safety with physical activity as well as obesity with women. One thing that is lacking in the literature is sort of the life course relationship between a neighborhood social environment and obesity. The studies that I showed you generally focus, or cross-sectional studies, where they look at one developmental time point. So adolescent neighborhood and adolescent obesity, or adult neighborhood and adult obesity. And in some of my current work, we're looking at the AdHealth study, which is a national longitudinal study of adolescent health, which follows a cohort of adolescents recruited in high school, it's nationally representative, and follows them into adulthood. And so we started at age 15, and the young, they're now young adults, they're at age 30, the cohort is age 30. And we're looking at a couple of measures of adolescent neighborhood social environment. So concentrated poverty measured by census tract block data, as well as the parental report in adolescents of public disorder, perceptions of safety, and informal control, or a measure of collective efficacy. And what we see when we look at adolescent neighborhood social environment and adult obesity or BMI levels at age 30 is, again, sort of a somewhat of a gender differential, in that women, we see a significant effect of neighborhood poverty, but no effect on our other measures of informal control or social disorder, but among men, we actually do see a significant effect among all the factors of poverty, safety, informal control, and social disorder. Somewhat inconsistent in terms of the effect of neighborhood safety, which what I had shown you before, which we see the effects really among women. But again, these are the adolescent environments on the long-term influence on obesity in adulthood, which may be accounting for the differential effects. And it's somewhat similar to what Theresa just showed, that you know, in adolescence, we do see that there is this impact among men from their neighborhood environment. Now, turning a little bit more to racial and ethnic segregation and obesity. So we know that racial ethnic segregated populations, there's an influence of, or there's an effect of racial segregation on socioeconomics, on the opportunities, on the availability of resources within a particular neighborhood. And this is Ann Haynes' data. We're looking at black women in this table, where we see that black isolation index is associated with obesity, even after adjustment for a number of other socioeconomic factors. We don't see the same thing for black men in this study, and this is consistent with what Yvette showed or mentioned with the Black Women's Health Study, where segregation is associated with higher levels of obesity. However, within Ann Haynes, when we look at Mexican-American women and we look at Hispanic isolation index, the opposite is true. Again, these effects are not seen among men. They're only seen among women. But in fact, there is a protective effect. So the more, the higher the isolation index, the less likely the women are to be obese. What is conferring a positive effect among one population and a detrimental effect among another population? It's really not known, but it's something that, you know, we should be looking into it and trying to figure out, you know, what are these factors and how can we actually disentangle what this racial ethnic isolation means for obesogenic behaviors that protects one group, but it's putting another group at risk. And so I'll mention very briefly my own work, which is on childhood obesity and cardiovascular health among a Puerto Rican cohort, which is embedded within the Boricua Youth Study. And this is a dual site study where we're looking at a Puerto Rican population. Half of the sample lives in the South Bronx, New York, or lived in the South Bronx, New York when they were children, and half of the sample in the San Juan metropolitan area of Puerto Rico. And the idea is really to look at the influence of social context among an ethnically homogeneous population and its impact on cardiometabolic health. These two populations are, you know, even though they're ethnically homogeneous, they're very different on a number of factors. And what we're seeing is that for obesity, we do have a very different prevalence among the two groups. In the Bronx, and this is preliminary data, we see higher prevalence, much higher prevalence of obesity, 39% compared to 21% in Puerto Rico. And these are young adults, they're about age 20, 21. So a very vulnerable group. I don't have neighborhood data to show you in terms of what we're collecting, but I can say that sort of this is kind of like what's to come. In terms of environmental factors, we're looking at housing quality and deterioration, as well as neighborhood physical and social environment, social cohesion and capital, perceived neighborhood safety, and then if we're lucky to get funded, we'll look at some traffic, outdoor air pollution in both sites, in addition to the other factors that we're considering for the larger cohort, for the larger study. So I talked a little bit about our limitations and future directions. I'll sort of reiterate, few studies have focused on individual behavior, so we have a lot of data on physical activity. When we're thinking, for example, of perceived safety and physical activity, we haven't gone beyond, well, what does it really mean that if you deem your neighborhood to be unsafe, you're spending more time indoors, and what does that time indoors mean for your, you know, your diet quality or your sleep or some other behavioral factors that may be influencing your BMI and your other cardiometabolic outcomes. The life course effects are not studied as often. The adolescent period is a developmental period, very important for the adoption of health behaviors that may last into adulthood. If we were to focus on, you know, the long-term impact of childhood and adolescent neighborhoods and how they carry over into, you know, adult behaviors via moderating behaviors in adolescence, we can potentially understand some of these mechanisms and for obesity prevention have an impact earlier in the life course. There is a need for intervention studies, and particularly studies that focus on social norms and how they're shared across neighborhoods, I think would be a really important area of research to try to understand how neighbors share information and how they set, you know, how norms are set within particular neighborhoods, particularly as they relate to diet and physical activity. And so I'll just end by saying, you know, there is a high prevalence of obesity in the United States. We have increasing evidence of an association between the social factors and obesogenic behaviors. And if we were to, you know, the efforts that we have in terms of addressing the built environment, if we now sort of add on this later social environment and focus on, you know, it's not to, I guess my presentation is not really to say we shouldn't focus on the physical environment, but really to integrate more social factors into our built environment research, we would have actually a more fruitful prevention of obesity as well as other cardiovascular risk factors. And I'll end there. Thank you.
So we have time for one question before we open it up for discussion. Yes.
So I don't actually currently collect that data, and it's a good point. I mean, it should be, you know, something, I guess, to add. It's not as extensively, or I haven't really seen it as extensively measured. So, you know, how affordable is the food around you? Yeah, that's a good point. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to invite the audience to provide their general thoughts and questions, which can be directed to any of our distinguished panelists.
Do we see?
Yes, back there. Shipped over. Yes. Go ahead.
Okay, yeah, just a comment on your presentation in terms of the differences between the African American and Hispanic. And I want to offer that it's possible that if you really disaggregate the Black American, you may find some interesting outcomes there. Because I think part of the reason why there's a positive outcome for the Hispanics is you have the ethnicity and the culture and the language that helps as a protective factor. Whereas the Black Americans, you know, you have the West Indians, you have all these groups that, you know, seem to be a homogenous group, but it's not. So that may be something that I think will, if you had the time to disaggregate.
Yeah, absolutely. So the work I present, so that's not my work on the NHANES data, but certainly there is a lot of heterogeneity within, you know, just the, you know, Black population as well as Hispanic population, and I should say that other studies among Latinos have not found the same protective effect. And it's sort of been alluded to, well, there's different levels of acculturation, years living in the U.S., composition of, you know, is it really just you're looking at, you know, all of Latinos? In NHANES, we have, you know, Mexican-American, so it's a little bit more homogeneous to actually be able to, you know, look at that, you know, it might be this shared cultural factors. So, yes, yeah, certainly within the Black population, that may be true as well.
Thank you. social policy and housing policy experts say that both, it's not an either or, both need to be invested in. Currently there are a lot of barriers to affordable housing using affordable housing vouchers, you know, one of which is the undersupply. I mean, the wait lists will open for, you know, a few days or a week in a certain metropolitan area or a certain city, and there's no way that the vouchers are meeting the need. So there's a much, that's one issue. The affordability of housing is really difficult right now among low-income populations, low-income families. So I'll say methodologically, when looking at, and Mariana may have more insight into this as a planner, but often with revitalization policy, investment in neighborhoods, often many resources are invested at the same time. It's difficult to differentiate among the investments that occur, and methodologically it's just very difficult to find comparisons to understand those effects on the populations, especially with turnover. They're both important.
Yeah, I would agree. I think that you've hit the nail on the head, and this is a constant tension, and I think that what you do here is, oh, we need both, and I think that's a little bit of a non-answer because we live in an environment of scarce resources. And I think that at least in the housing world and the planning world, people do sort of fall into two different camps. And I mean, one thing I would say about it is that I think that sometimes our opportunity mapping frameworks and the things that we sort of count as assets can sometimes ignore the rich social capital and the connections and the vibrancy of some of our urban neighborhoods that are really important for health and for other forms of well-being. And I think it's not just an empirical question. I also think it's kind of a philosophical and a moral question of, should you be given the opportunity to thrive in the neighborhood where you make your home and where you have your social connections? And so I think it is both, but I do think that a mobility solution is probably not the solution for the majority of people, and that we need to be investing in neighborhoods without displacing vulnerable residents is my personal feeling on it.
Thanks for four great presentations. I have a question inspired by the observation that you're sitting up there flanked on both sides by tweet walls. I've never seen this in a meeting before. It's very cool. It gives the meeting a presidential feeling. It is a reminder that more and more of our social context, our sense of connectedness with other people, our communities are digital rather than physical. How should we be thinking about that in terms of the ways in which place and
start and say a limitation of the data that we have in the Black Women's Health Study is we can map to the residential neighborhood, but we really have no idea how much time is spent there, how much time is spent in a different environment where someone may work or with a relative and so on. So that's a huge limitation that we have. Digitally, our cohort is a little older now, but some are connected through social media with our study, but still we don't quite know where they are in, you know, physically in time and space. So perhaps some of your studies can look at that.
Well, I know one of my colleagues, Quinn Nguyen, has been using social media data to try to operationalize the social environment of neighborhoods by using geocoded Twitter and Facebook posts and trying to see if we can capture the social environment in a different way. And so she's been examining that with the big data 2K NIH mechanism in her career development award. And I think it's really innovative to try to understand if we can leverage some of this big data, which is often very shallow, but may give us a very different view of the environment. And so currently she's validating some of these measures to see whether it's possible, and that may give us a different view.
And I call her we've looked at in relation to social support, and so we're trying to characterize the support that is a physical, people you actually see is well as people that you don't see but you can actually connect to electronically.
Just say beyond the beyond sort of the research implications of having better data and the kind of push towards mobile health technologies, I think this kind of gets at a question of sometimes the planners discuss it, like, are we headed into an era where, you know, the end of space, where space is irrelevant for us? You know, you combine this with, you know, on-demand delivery of things, and do you really need to have your, you know, do you really need to have the retail environment and the food environment when you can have, you know, Fresh Direct or something? And do you really need to have, like, place-based social capital when you have Twitter and you have Facebook and stuff like that? And I think it's, I definitely think it's something to keep an eye on, but it doesn't seem like in the data that that's being borne out just yet, right? It still looks like with the most recent data that place really matters, and I think this gets to Dean Galea's initial points about the ubiquity of the residential environment and how it structures everything else around us. And so I think it's something to keep an eye on, but I don't think we're there yet.
So we need to wrap up in the interest of time, but I have some few concluding remarks, and we're available during lunchtime to continue on the conversation. And the first is that the findings from these presentations really highlight the integration of multi-level and life course perspectives, particularly what this means in terms of the implications for developing policies and programs. The second is that, as we've seen from the research, our physical, social, and digital landscapes are changing rapidly, now more so than ever, and so too must the neighborhood-level interventions that we develop, implement, and disseminate. Third is that there likely is no one-size-fits-all solution, particularly given the vast differences in geography, climate, urbanicity, and residential composition, as well as needs of various neighborhoods and cities and towns across the U.S. And lastly, our conversation today is an iterative, dynamic process, and each of our panelists discussed the importance and need to integrate and collaborate across sectors in order to promote population health and to target health disparities within the context of where we live. So thank you all to our panelists this morning, and thank you all.
Hi, well, thanks again to all the speakers and panelists from this morning. It's a great start to the day. Just two quick process points. Our next keynote speaker will be Ron Sims. Before he speaks, though, everyone should get their lunches and bring them back to your seats. The lunches are in the back. We'd love to let Ron start as close to 11:45 as possible, so let's all move expeditiously. We want to hear everything that he has to say. Just one other quick point before everyone gets up. When you ask questions, certainly encourage everyone to use the mics. It's hard to hear from one side of the room to the other, and those who are live streaming would benefit from that. So please wait till the mic arrives. There's a few of them floating around. Thanks.